Well, hello and welcome to another True Light Fellowship Church Wednesday night Bible study. My name is Morris Scott, and on behalf of our pastor and founder, Dr. Wesley Pinnock, we're glad that you have joined us tonight. Listen, it's always a good time to listen to the Word of God. It's always the right time to hear the Word of God, for God's Word brings healing. God's Word brings light. God's Word can break every stronghold, and God's Word brings life. But before we get too excited, let's commit our time to the Lord. Father, we just thank you for this day that you've allowed us to see. We don't take anything for granted, but we thank you for every mercy that you send our way. We thank you for your faithfulness. We just acknowledge you right now as we open up your word. We pray that you would send your sacred presence. We pray that your Holy Spirit would be with us tonight to teach us, to open up our understanding, that we might learn more about you and grow and apply it in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. So today we'd like to study the life of Simon Peter. We'd like to study about the life of Simon Peter. This is the Peter that walked with Jesus. This is the Peter that ate with Jesus. This is the Peter that journeyed with Jesus. This is the Peter that wrote 1st and 2nd Peter in the Bible, and who most probably dictated the Gospel of Mark to John Mark. What kind of a person was he? Was he a tower of strength? Was he this perfect, strong person? Or did he have areas of weakness? Did he at times fall short of who we should be? So let's look at Simon Peter. Let's look at the lows and the highs of Simon Peter. Let's take a close look at the failures and the successes of Simon Peter. Let's look at the growth of Simon Peter, and let's also see if there is a Simon Peter in you or if there's a Simon Peter in me. Let's look a little closer through the lens of Scripture. Let's journey along in the drama of the gospel and see, in one sense, how Christ dealt with Peter, and it might give us a clue as to how Jesus deals with us. So the first example we'd like to take a look at is Peter, the fisherman, encounters Jesus. Peter, the fisherman, encounters Christ. We're going to look at Luke chapter 5. We're going to read verses 1 through 8. And it reads, "So it was, as the multitude pressed about him to hear the word of God, that he stood by the lake of Gennesaret, and saw two boats standing by the lake. But the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. When he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, 'Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch.' But Simon answered and said to him, 'Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net.' And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, 'Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord.'" So here we see that this Peter, he was in one sense a raw, rugged, get it done type of person. He wasn't a lazy person. He was working. He had his own boat. We see glimpses of his obedient response to Christ, for he let him use his boat. Now, maybe he was just being hospitable to who he thought was a great teacher, but he also launched out at the word of Christ. Now, the word of Christ had power, and still does, as we saw from his calling of the disciples, and they all left what they were doing and followed him. But we see Peter coming in contact with Jesus, his power, and also his glory in this text. For why would Peter say, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord"? Why would he say that? There was something about the presence of Christ that revealed the glory of the Lord. There was something about the presence of Christ that revealed the holiness of God. There was something about the presence of Christ that revealed the conviction of the Holy Spirit. It brought conviction upon Peter. Listen, when you see the glory of God, true revelation of the glory of God, this will bring conviction of man's sin. This is why in Isaiah chapter 6, when Isaiah saw the Lord in the year that King Uzziah died, one of the things that he said was, "Woe is me." People who are not convicted by their sins are people that have not seen the glory of God yet. Let's look at another example. Let's look at Peter walking on water. This is Matthew chapter 14 and verses 25 through 33. And it reads, "Now in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, 'It is a ghost.' And they cried out for fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, 'Be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be afraid.' And Peter answered him and said, 'Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water.' And he said, 'Come.' And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, 'Lord, save me.' And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him and said to him, 'O you of little faith, why did you doubt?' And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. Then those who were in the boat came and worshiped him, saying, 'Truly, you are the Son of God.'" So we see that it was night. The fourth watch of the night, that was the last part of the night between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. It's still dark. The question is, what do you do when there is darkness in your life, when you can't see your way? We have to also notice that the sea in biblical history often represented chaos or a hurdle or great difficulty or that which has no form. We see, for example, Genesis chapter 1, verse 2, that the earth was without form and void. We see in Exodus that the children of Israel, after coming out of Egypt, found themselves where? At the Red Sea, with the sea before them and Pharaoh behind them. We see the children of Israel ready to go into the promised land, but confronted with the River Jordan in Joshua chapter 3, verses 14 through 17. But back in the example of our text in Matthew chapter 14, what we do see now, what is Jesus doing? What is he doing with respect to the sea? That which represents chaos, confusion, hindrance, we see Jesus walking on, showing his conquest over it, his conquest over the chaos, his conquest over confusion, his conquest over every hurdle or every hindrance in our lives. But we see now Peter seeing this and saying a strange thing. What did Peter say? He's saying, "If it is you, let me come." In other words, regardless of the danger that exists, as long as I know that it is you and your presence is with me, I'm willing to face the danger. This is the level of faith that we should have in our lives, especially in this day and age where there's so many challenges and so many uncertainties in this world. Jesus invites him to come, and we see Peter now walking on water. Wow. But we see what will be one of many examples of Peter's imperfection, of his need to grow, of his faith on one hand, but imperfection on the other. He began to look at the winds and the waves and began to sink. This is often what we do as well. We have a moment of victory. We praise the Lord. Then in a moment of opposition from the enemy, in a moment of setbacks in life, we begin to do what? To doubt God, even after we've just experienced his great power. But thank God for his mercy. Thank God for his mercy. We see Jesus lifting Peter back up. Yes, in the midst of our inconsistent faith, God is merciful and he will help us so that we do not fall. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 18, you can see a reference for that. We also see that people are not perfect, and so our eyes, our dependency cannot be purely on people, even great people, because they can fail. Our dependency must be on Jesus alone. Let's look at another example. Let's look at Peter's confession that Jesus is the Christ. This takes place in Matthew chapter 16 and verses 13 through 18. Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 18. And it reads, "When Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, 'Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?' So they said, 'Some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets.' He said to them, 'But who do you say that I am?' Simon Peter answered and said, 'You are the Christ, the Son of the living God.' Jesus answered and said to him, 'Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it.'" So we see Jesus asking a few questions. And I love the many examples in scripture where we see God asking questions, because it really gives us a model for ministry, a model for ministry. We see other examples of this in Genesis chapter 3, verse 9, where God asked Adam after he sinned, "Where are you, Adam? Where are you?" Now, don't you think that God knew where Adam was? Of course God knew where Adam was. We see also God asking Cain in Genesis chapter 4, verse 9, "Where is your brother? Where is Abel your brother?" Of course God knew what happened to Abel. Sometimes in ministry, again, this is the model for ministry, but sometimes in ministry, we do so much talking. We do so much talking, but a good teacher will ask questions and invite answers to expose the mindset of the student. Here, Jesus knew all things, but for their benefit, he asked who he is. There were a few answers that the disciples gave, but to the second question that Jesus asked, Jesus said, "Who do you say that I am?" Peter is the one now who answers that Jesus is the Christ. So we see Peter strongly and boldly declaring the identity of Jesus. We see Peter being an agent of revelation from the Father, as a text says. Peter is commended now by Christ. He's commended by Christ, as Christ also declares that upon this confession that Peter made, the church will be built and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. But while we are looking up to Peter, while we are seeing him as such a great and a strong leader, while we are seeing him as an instrument of divine revelation, while we are seeing him as this great person, we see quite another story that's coming up. We see quite another story that's developing. Let's look now then at Matthew 16 and verses 21 through 23, where we are going to see the rebuke of Peter by Christ. Verse 21 says, "From that time, Jesus began to show to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, 'Far be it from you, Lord, this shall not happen to you.' But he turned and said to Peter, 'Get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men.'" Wow. So we see that Christ begins to explain now. He begins to explain what true ministry looks like to Peter. He begins to show the afflictions of ministry. He begins to show at what many call the road less traveled, or the road least traveled. He begins to show the way of the cross, the way of the master. And Peter does not like this. Peter does not like this. He no doubt believed that Jesus would become a political king and physically fight the Romans. Listen, so many people see ministry as the ascension to glory, human glory, conquest, comfort, fancy suits, expensive cars, big houses, and some of them even call it the favor of God. Some might even preach that if you're experiencing difficulty in life, it's because somehow you're not in the will of God. But Christ modeled ministry by walking to his death so that he would eventually fulfill his high priestly duties, Hebrews chapter 4, 15 through 16. And as Peter began to rebuke Jesus, to tell Jesus, no, it won't happen. Wow. As R.C. Sproul says, these two phrases, no and Lord, they are oxymorons. They do not go with each other. If you're going to call someone Lord, it means they know what they're doing. It means they know more than you. And so you can't say no to the Lord. Your answer should always be yes. But we see Jesus' response now. The kind Jesus who lifted Peter from sinking in the water and commended him on his confession of Jesus as the Christ is now rebuking Peter, is now rebuking Peter and saying, get behind me, Satan. Listen, it doesn't matter how wonderfully someone is used by God or how anointed they may appear to be or what powerful deeds they have done. If there comes a time where they are speaking heresy or they are conducting themselves in a way that is not proper, they must be rebuked. They must be rebuked. We must not be drawn so much to personalities that we take our eyes off of whether what someone is doing lines up to sacred scripture. The giftedness is fine, but I want to see the Galatians 5 fruit of the Spirit. For it is by their fruits that you shall know them. That's Matthew chapter 7, verse 16. So Christ rebukes Peter. Now, he was not calling Peter Satan, but he was recognizing that Satan was operating at that time through Peter, speaking through Peter to prevent Christ from fulfilling his calling. And listen, if Peter, someone so close to the person of Christ, can be used by the devil to hinder the work of the Lord, then you never know. You never know who can be used by the devil. And that's why you have to keep your eyes on Jesus and watch and pray. That's Matthew chapter 26, verse 41. Take your eyes off of people. Don't trust in the arm of the flesh. That's Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 5. But notice now, Christ does not abandon Peter. Christ does not throw away Peter. He doesn't fire him from being a disciple. He corrects him and then he moves on. Let's look at another event, another incident in the life of Peter. Peter's witness of the transfiguration. That's Matthew chapter 17 and verses 1 through 9. Now, after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. Then Peter answered and said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, let us make here 3 tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. But Jesus came and touched them and said, arise and do not be afraid. When they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. Now, as they came down from the mountain, Jesus commanded them, saying, tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man is risen from the dead. So what do we have here? We see Christ taking Peter, James, and John, the inner circle, if you will, to a higher level, on a mountain to see something special. Listen, God wants to take you to a higher level so that you can see something special, to experience something special in him. Christ was transfigured. That word transfigured, it means a radical change. It means a revolutionary change. It means a metamorphosis. Meta meaning big and morpho meaning change or change of form. It's the same word that's used in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, where Paul says that we should not be conformed to this pattern of the world, but we should be what? Transformed. A big radical change. We should be transformed by the renewing or by the renovations of our mind. But now this change in the countenance of Christ, it took place as he prayed, The Matthew account does not reveal this, but it is revealed in Luke chapter 9 and verse 29. But what does Peter say? Amidst all of this going on, what does Peter say? He says, it's great to be here. Make three tabernacles. Just think of it, amid the powerful revelation of who Christ is by the Father, amid Moses and Elijah speaking of Christ's decease to come, Luke chapter 9, verse 31. Peter is now talking about how it feels. He's talking about a building program, if you will. Wow. But sometimes, you know, we are no different. Sometimes we are no different amid the glory of the gospel and the task that the church is given to win the lost. We are just concerned with feeling good in church, our personal experience in church, building a bigger edifice so that we can show off to other people that we have something great going on. What's the motive? Is it kingdom building? Or is it the shallow building of things which are here today and gone tomorrow? We see the patient Christ with the immature but still growing Peter. We see Christ being patient with the immature but still growing Peter. By immature, we don't mean it in a bad sense, but like as a fruit on a tree that still has ripening to undergo before it is plucked. We see Christ telling the disciples not to mention their experience. Listen, we live in a world where people want to mention every single experience that they have. They want to put it on social media. They want to put it on Facebook, on Instagram, on Twitter. They want to tell everybody. They want to announce it so that people can see what a great and powerful person they are. But listen, there are some things. There are some things that God may want you to keep between you and he. The Bible says that Mary pondered these things in her heart after being given certain revelations concerning the child Jesus. That's Luke chapter 2, verse 19. Certainly, there's a time to speak, but there's also a time to remain silent. That's Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 7. Let's look at another event in the life of Peter. Let's look at Peter at the Lord's Supper. That's John chapter 13, and we're going to read verses 3 through 9. And it reads, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper and laid aside his garments, took a towel and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. Then he came to Simon Peter, and Peter said to him, Lord, are you washing my feet? Jesus answered and said to him, what I am doing you do not understand now, but you will after this. Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. So here we see again Peter in effect saying, no, Lord. Again, those two words should never be said together. For if you're calling Christ Lord, that means he knows what he is doing. It means that he is all powerful. It means that he will not err. But Peter didn't know what Christ was doing. So we see Peter speaking in ignorance. It's not a bad word, but we mean only that he did not know. He did not know, and yet he was speaking, actually commanding God. Listen, It's a very bad thing to lack understanding and to be commanding people, let alone trying to command Almighty God. Before you issue commands, make sure you get understanding. I would even say before you open your mouth and talk, make sure you get understanding. In all that you do, get understanding, says Proverbs chapter 4, verse 7. So we see Peter commanding Jesus. Wow. And then is rebuked again. But notice that although Peter was this bold, speak first type of person, when rebuked, we do see him accept the rebuke, and his life would be changed by it. Yes, he was a what you see is what you get type person, but he also appeared to be ready to accept rebuke. And because of that, we are seeing and will continue to see growth in his life. Now, what about you? What type of a person are you? Do you receive rebuke? What do you do when you are rebuked? Do you return fire? Do you leave the church? Do you get mad? Or do you fall on your knees in brokenness before the Lord and say, Spirit of the Lord, fall afresh on me, break me, melt me, mold me, and fill me. So Peter then said, wash all of me. And if you read further on in the text and other parallel texts, you see that Christ said, no, washing your feet is sufficient. So Peter seemed like this all or none type of person. In one sense, he was at the extreme parts of the spectrum. Sometimes we can be like that too. Sometimes in ministry, if we do it, we want to go all the way as fast and as forceful and as quickly as we can, but sometimes balance is required. Going all the way with the experience is good, but temperance is still required. Wisdom and discretion are required. Judgment is required so that we may be effective as it relates to the gospel. Jesus is calling us to have spiritual maturity to be able to see that. And that is what teaching is supposed to provide. Let's look at another example. Peter's overconfidence before Christ. Matthew chapter 26, we're going to read verses 31 through 35. And it reads, then Jesus said to them, all of you will be made to stumble because of me this night, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee. Peter answered and said to him, even if all are made to stumble because of you, I will never be made to stumble. Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you that this night before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. Peter said to him, even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you. And so said all the disciples. So we see a lot of drama taking place at the most critical moment in the earthly life of Christ. A lot of drama going on. The time when Christ's disciples should act mature, they are not acting as mature as they should. Peter is again saying, no, Lord, in effect. He's saying against the word of Christ that he will not betray him. Peter is trusting in his own strength. Peter is trusting in his own passion. Listen, passion alone is a very dangerous thing. Passion alone will make you think you're right when you're wrong. Passion alone will make you even do something that is right in the wrong way. Passion alone will make your good evil spoken of. And so Peter loved Christ. Peter wanted to help Christ, but passion alone is insufficient for effectiveness in ministry. There must be the power of the Holy Spirit and his grace to empower us to do what we otherwise could not do. That is what Peter has yet to learn. Peter also pretty much said, I will do I can do what the other disciples cannot do. I'm going to do what the other disciples cannot do. They may stumble, but I won't. So there was a little bit of boastfulness, maybe a little bit of arrogance, a little bit of overconfidence in self. Listen, ministry and overconfidence is a dangerous mix. Ministry and boastfulness is a dangerous mix. Ministry and arrogance is a dangerous combination. The only way to successfully do ministry is through brokenness before the Lord. And Peter would have to discover and experience this. Let's look at another example. We see Peter the warrior. John chapter 18, 3 through 11, it says, "Then Judas, having received a detachment of troops and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, came there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that would come upon him, went forward and said to them, 'Whom are you seeking?' They answered, 'Jesus of Nazareth.' Jesus said to them, 'I am he.' And Judas, who betrayed him, also stood with them. Now, when he said to them, 'I am he,' they drew back and fell to the ground. Then he asked them again, 'Whom are you seeking?' And they said, 'Jesus of Nazareth.' Jesus answered, 'I have told you that I am he. Therefore, if you seek me, let these go their way, that the saying might be fulfilled, which he spoke, of those whom you gave me, I have lost none.' Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. So Jesus said to Peter, 'Put up your sword into the sheath. Shall I not drink the cup which my Father has given me?'" So, doesn't it feel exciting that Peter should defend Christ? Doesn't it feel so dramatic that Peter should, by any means necessary, protect Christ? Doesn't it feel good that there's somebody that's going to take charge and take care of business when wicked, evil things are being done and said? But hold on. Just because it feels good doesn't mean that it is good. This is not the way of the Master. This is not the way of the cross. The ends do not justify the means. Just because the cause is right does not mean that you can use whatever means you please to achieve it. That's taking matters into your own hands. Listen, the hardest thing to do is to watch ungodly things happen and not take matters into your own hands. But God is not calling any one of us to take matters into our own hands and to act in our own strength. That's a great way to mess things up. See Genesis chapter 16, verses 1 through 5 for the example of Abraham, Sarah, and Hagar. So God is calling us to put up our sword, to stop fighting evil with our own power, with our own emotions, with our own weapons. There is some suffering. Listen, there is some suffering we will have to endure simply because we are servants of Christ, and the servant is not greater than his Lord. That's John chapter 13, verse 16. A part of being crucified with Christ, Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, and being a living sacrifice, Romans chapter 12, verse 1, is enduring the afflictions, but we know that the Lord will deliver us out of them all. And of course, that's Psalm 34, verse 19. Let's look at another example. Let's look at Peter denying Jesus, Matthew chapter 26, verses 69 through 75. "Now Peter sat outside in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him saying, 'You also were with Jesus of Galilee.' But he denied it before them all, saying, 'I do not know what you are saying.' And when he had gone out to the gateway, another girl saw him and said to those who were there, 'This fellow also was with Jesus of Nazareth.' But again, he denied with an oath, 'I do not know the man.' And a little later, those who stood by came up and said to Peter, 'Surely you also are one of them, for your speech betrays you.' Then he began to curse and swear," wow, "saying, 'I do not know the man.' Immediately the rooster crowed, and Peter remembered the word of Jesus, who said to him, 'Before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times.' So we went out and wept bitterly." Wow. So we see here failure. We see the letdown. We see discouragement. We see defeat. And it would be one thing if his denial was in a small private corner. But who is standing there, if you read some of the parallel accounts, who is standing there looking at him but Jesus himself? Wow. It's all bad, right? No, it's not all bad. There is a lot of good happening here in the midst of this failure. Why? Because there is something else that is occurring. There's something else that's occurring here, and that something else is called brokenness. Brokenness before the Lord. This brokenness tears down pride. This brokenness tears off the mask. This brokenness tears down self-sufficiency. This brokenness tears down the arm of the flesh. It tears down one's ego. It tears down carnality until the only thing that's left is Peter. Empty Peter looking at Jesus. And this is where God wants us to be. Empty of our carnality, empty of our arrogance, empty of our ego, and God will use trying circumstances to bring us to that place of brokenness. But the consolation is that at this place of brokenness, if you look very carefully, you will see Jesus. If you listen very carefully, you will hear the voice of the Lord speaking. Notice that although Peter denied Jesus and saw Jesus' face, Peter merely weeps, which is quite different. It's a different outcome than Judas, who after Satan entered in him, Luke chapter 22, verse 3, and he betrayed Christ, he went and hung himself. That's Matthew chapter 27, verse 3. Both failed, but it seemed as though Peter had a relationship with Jesus, which allowed him to humble himself and to move on from his failure. And the lesson is, just because you hit rock bottom and fail and mess up does not mean that your life is over. God forgives and gives a second chance, for he will abundantly pardon. And that's Isaiah chapter 55, 7 through 9. I feel like I need to say that one more time. The lesson is, just because you hit rock bottom, somebody might be at rock bottom right now listening to this, but just because you hit rock bottom and fail and mess up, it does not mean that your life is over. God is a God of a second chance. Let's look at another example. Peter restored by Christ by the sea. John chapter 21, verses 15 through 16. So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Feed my lambs." He said to him again a second time, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him a third time, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me?" Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." So we see Peter being asked by Christ whether he loved him three times, the same amount of times that Peter denied Christ. Some have gone as far as to say that Christ was undoing the anguish of Peter's failure in denying Christ that perhaps Peter was feeling inside his spirit, inside his heart. But as we dig a little closer, we see that the first two questions Christ was initially asking Peter, whether he had the agape love for Christ, that sacrificial love that considers the interests of the other person before your own interests. Peter answers that he does have the phileo love for Christ, that brotherly love. But the third time Christ asked the question, he uses Peter's own words, the phileo word, and Peter says that Christ knows that Peter phileo, that Peter loves Christ. So what do we gather from this? Listen, Christ will meet us at the point in life where we are. But make no mistake, he won't leave you there. He enters your world in order to bring you into his. Any man who has an encounter with Christ will not be the same again, will not stay the same place for long, and will not speak the same words again. For if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things are new. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. So we see Christ restoring Peter. Peter would know that he is forgiven, but Christ is restoring Peter to ministry as well. Christ tells Peter to feed my lambs. It's a word that means attend to the needs of my animals. Christ is calling Peter to do the work of ministry, which was not being a loud boss, which is not trying to be in charge all the time, which is not trying to seek the foremost position all the time, which is not showing off, which is not being served by people, but tending to the needs of God's people. Listen, this is the essence of ministry. Christ the second time tells Peter to tend my sheep, which means watch out for them. Watch out for them. Shepherd them. Make sure that they're going in the right direction. This, my friend, is the essence of ministry. This is the essence of leadership in ministry. And then the third time, Jesus returns to the first meaning of feed my sheep. Let's look at another example. Let's look at Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, 12 through 17, and 37 through 41. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as a fire, and one sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Verse 12, so they were all amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, what could this mean? Others mocking said, they are full of new wine. But Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and heed my words. For these are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Verse 37. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call. And with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. Wow. All I can say is wow. There is a difference between the pre-Pentecost Peter and the post-Pentecost Peter. Something happened on the day of Pentecost which changed Peter. He was endued and infused with power from on high, the power of the Holy Ghost, not just to feel good, not just to get a fix, not to show off, but to do kingdom work, to do kingdom service, to speak words that Peter was before too fearful to speak, to do deeds that would actually land them in jail and cause them to be beaten and ultimately to be put to death. Listen, this power comes not from any human strength, but from the Holy Ghost. May we all be filled with this power for such a time as this. Let's look at another event in the life of Peter, Acts chapter 5, 12 through 16, where we see the sick healed when Peter's shadow passed by. And it says, and through the hands of the apostles, many signs and wonders were done among the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch. Yet none of the rest dared join them, but the people esteemed them highly. And believers were increasingly added to the Lord, multitudes of both men and women, so that they brought the sick out into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at least the shadow of Peter passing by might fall on some of them. Also, a multitude gathered from the surrounding cities to Jerusalem, bringing sick people and those who were tormented by unclean spirits, and they were all healed. So we see the effects of the post-Pentecost Peter. The power of God operating through him to such an extent that his very shadow passing by the sick would cause them to be healed. What a remarkable change in the one who was saying beforehand the wrong things, rebuking Christ, denying Christ. Listen, when you approach the consuming fire of Almighty God, regardless of who you are, regardless of what your issues are, when you approach the consuming fire of the presence of Almighty God, he will burn away what's not like him, and he will make you into something totally different. I'm a witness. but something that will turn this world upside down for the glory of God. Let's look at another event in Peter's life. Peter rebuked by Paul, Galatians chapter 2, 11 through 16. And it says, now when Peter had come to Antioch, I withstood him to his face because he was to be blamed. For before certain men came from James, he would eat with the Gentiles. But when they came, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing those who were of the circumcision. And the rest of the Jews also played the hypocrite with him, so that even Barnabas was carried away with their hypocrisy. But when I saw that they were not straightforward about the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter before them all, if you, being a Jew, live in the manner of Gentiles and not as the Jews, why do you compel Gentiles to live as Jews? We who are Jews by nature and not sinners of the Gentiles, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Christ Jesus, that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified. So we see here that in spite of Peter's growth, despite of his leadership, despite of the great signs and wonders and miracles that were done through him, he was not perfect. He was not perfect. Listen, no one is perfect. Don't elevate anyone to a position where you blindly believe everything that they say, where you have blind trust in them, looking away from the word of God. Yes, trust people, but make sure you keep one eye on scripture. And if they depart from sacred scripture, be ready to call it out respectfully, but still error should not go unchecked. We learn not just from what is said here, but also from what is not said. We don't see in the Galatian text that Peter gave some rebuttal, some big argument to fight Paul, fighting with him. I believe Peter took Paul's words the same way that he took Christ's rebuke, humbly and with grace. And Peter grew thereby. He grew thereby. Finally, we see that Christ predicted that Peter would suffer greatly for him and be martyred even. John chapter 21, verses 18 through 19. And if you do some research and look at the book, Fox's Book of Martyrs, tells of Peter's death, that he was about to be crucified, and he declared that he should not be crucified upright, but he should be put upside down because he was not worthy to be crucified in the same manner as the Lord Jesus Christ. You'll find that in chapter 1 of the Fox Book of Martyrs. And so what a different Peter that we have from the one that first met Christ, or the one that even denied Christ. In conclusion, what we see is the transformation of Peter. It was not an overnight process. It was not a pretty process. At times, it was a very ugly process. But this process, God's divine process, we can trust. We see that God is patient with us, that God is merciful to us, even in our imperfections, even in our failures. But we see that God is not afraid to rebuke us. God even reserves the right to use key people to sharpen or rebuke us, regardless of how high we think we are. Well, I pray that the word tonight has been a blessing to you. May you be richly strengthened thereby. Don't forget that if you would like to worship the Lord in the giving of your tithes and offerings, you can use the church website, or you can bring your offering to church as well. We certainly don't want to dismiss without whispering a word of prayer. We want to remember certainly the bereaved, those that have lost loved ones. We want to certainly remember our sister Martha Shedrick, whose son is being funeralized this Saturday morning at 9 o'clock a.m. Yes, 9 o'clock sharp. Let's all support her during this time. Let's also pray for our youth, that the Lord would just pour out his spirit among our youth and bring revival. Let's also remember to pray for those that don't know the Lord and the pardoning of their sins. Let's pray for our government leaders. Let's pray for our church leaders. And let's certainly pray for our cities. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for this word today. We thank you for your patience with us as we look at the life of Peter, and we see how you treated him in the midst of his imperfections. We just thank you that you are patient with us, that you are long-suffering with us. And we pray that you would make us more like you as we go through this process that we spoke of. We pray that you would help us, Lord, to experience brokenness before you, that we might be made and molded in the image of Christ. Father, we pray that you would touch those that are bereaved. We pray and lift up right now our sister Martha, that you would just touch her from the crown of her head to the tip of her toe and her family, that you would just bring peace and your grace in the midst of this difficult situation. Strengthen her right now in the name of Jesus, we pray, and comfort her right now in the name of Jesus. And all those who are bereaved, we pray that you would just touch them and give them the peace of God that passeth all understanding. We pray that you would touch those that don't know you in the pardoning of their sins. We pray that you would put a hook in their jaw. We pray, Lord God, that you'd bring them out of darkness into your marvelous light. Father, we pray for our government. We pray that you would touch our leaders, our civic leaders, touch those that are in authority. We pray that you would give them wisdom and discretion, understanding in all things. In the name of Jesus, we pray. We pray that you would touch our church leaders, touch our pastor. We lift up Pastor Pinnock and Sister Pinnock, that you would just touch them, uphold them, Lord, preserve them, sustain them. We pray that you would touch our associate pastors, our ministers, our elders, our deacons, our deaconesses, all those that are laboring in the vineyard. We pray that you would just uphold them and strengthen them in the name of Jesus, we pray. Pray that you would touch our youth. Pray that you would send revival among them in the name of Jesus. Use them for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.